As is our usual custom, we'll now take a quick look at His Excellency the next Governor after Richard Bourke, and that was Sir George Gipps. Now, he was born in 1791, the son of a clergyman, and after schooling in Canterbury and education at the Royal Military Academy, he took on a career in the army. Now, he found staff duties more attractive or more in keeping with his skills than actual fighting. It doesn't mean to say he was a coward or didn't like the front lines, but indeed at the Battle of Waterloo he was up to his captain's epaulets in paperwork. A bit like his predecessor, Governor Bourke, Gipps was a Whig, I guess a progressive in today's terms. He was promoted to Major and made a Knight. He was a diligent worker and would rise early and work for the rest of the day. He got his satisfaction from hard work and his religious belief and the encouragement of his loving wife. Unfortunately, he was a man who would not trust or could not trust anybody to handle the detail, and he would perhaps be called a micromanager in today's parlance. In the next 6 years, he was to preside over a colony of New South Wales, which was literally growing beyond its boundaries and would lead to the eventual splitting of New South Wales into New South Wales and Victoria. Now, this boundary process, splitting the colonies, his predecessor would oversee. And much is said today about the treatment of the Aboriginals by the Europeans in this colonial period. In hindsight, and with perhaps a different set of values or emphasis on those values that may not have been around in the 19th century, we look on in abhorrence at how the Indigenous people were treated. Now, as I mentioned in the previous video, there was in fact brutality occurring from both sides, both Europeans and from the Indigenous. But let me be very clear, there is no case to develop for either championing or one side or the other. It is of note, however, that all inhabitants of New South Wales, including the Indigenous, were subject to and protected as His Majesty's subjects, both natives and white people, with the full weight of the law and its protection. Now this fact is often misunderstood or not known, or even recognised as an event. In fact, it led to the arrest, trial and conviction of the ringleaders of the Myall Massacre of June 1838. Governor Gipps believed that justice should be done and should prevail. And look, in this, he was not dragged kicking and screaming to order the trial, but he was pushing against a massive movement at the time by the entrenched landowners and pastoralists, who had a disparaging view on the Indigenous peoples and their value. Horrific, we say today, and rightly so, and we're probably very much entitled to that view. However, we must try and place ourselves in that time and in that place in the late colonial period. Now, clearly this is not to justify in any respect one side's prominence over the other, but to recognise that there was a complexity in the society, and especially in rural Australia, about the treatment of the Indigenous people, their value to civilisation, and how to manage them. Now, Governor Gipps was involved in many aspects of education and immigration in his six-year tenure, but after having arrived back in London in December 1846, he soon became very ill, had a heart attack, and died at the age of 57 on the 28th of February 1847. So there's a snapshot of the governor who replaced Richard Bourke. Governor Gipps was a proud man and he had a temper, but he did promote the interests of New South Wales during that turbulent period. I'm Michael Bischel. It's bye for now.